to us this morning.
Good morning, beloved of my Father. I would like to take this moment and greet you all in the wonderful name of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
It is my singular pleasure to be here with you this morning. I have had the pleasure and the privilege of being in the group since May. I have been prayed for. I have also had a moment to pray for people. And I have also benefited from the messages that have been preached in this platform. I'm excited that God has seen fit to use someone like me, an ordinary person like me, to pour into the hearts of his people. And I just want to say to you out there,
if God can use me, he can use anyone. If God can use me, he can use anyone. So because it is a Women's Month in South Africa, allow me to take this moment and just celebrate my dearly beloved sisters, the young ladies out there, the older ladies, the mothers, the aunts, the stepmoms, the aunties, the grannies, the beautiful princesses. Allow me just to celebrate the last bones of creation, you know, those special people about whom, after God had first created them, he says, it is very good. It is very good. I just want to celebrate you women out there as I celebrate myself also, not as a rock this time. I don't want to celebrate you as a woman that holds the knife, but on the sharp end. I don't want to celebrate the strength of your resilience or your endurance this morning. But I just want to celebrate the strength of our vulnerability, our ability to feel our own pain as well as the pain of others, our ability to laugh and cry at the same time. I want to celebrate the fact that we know that we can stand and fight without depriving ourselves of an opportunity to feel. I want to celebrate the fact that we are women who bleed before we heal. I want to take this moment and celebrate the very things that society, including ourselves, thinks make us weak. I want to celebrate the humanness of our womanhood. And I just want to pray a special blessing upon you, that the Lord may bless you, that the Lord may keep you, that the Lord may shine his countenance upon you, that he may establish the work of your hands, and that he may stretch your territory, and that he may give you so much water that you'll never thirst after anything else. And in you, that he'll also create this fountain that overflows into life everlasting. And now we're going to go to the word. Let us take a moment to pray. Oh, dear Jesus. What a pleasure to get up and fall into the everlasting arms. What a pleasure to get up and declare your loving kindness and your faithfulness. And this morning, we just want to pray once again that your spirit may terminate with us. I just pray, God, that as your word is spoken to your people, as your word falls on me as well, that I might be renewed, I might be restored. This is my prayer, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my soul may be pleasing unto you, O God. Amen. So I am going to read from the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 12. I'm going to read from verse 1 to 7. It's 2 Samuel, chapter 12, from verse 1 to 7. Then the Lord sent Nathan to David, and he came to him and said to him, there were two men in one city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceedingly many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished. And it grew up together with him and with his children. It ate of his own food and drank from his own cup and lay in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. And a traveler came to the rich man, who refused to take from his own flock and from his own herd to prepare one for the wayfaring man who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him. So David's anger was greatly aroused against the man, and he said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, the man who has done this shall surely die, and he shall restore fourfold for the lamb because he did this thing and because he had no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are the man. Nathan said to David, you are the man. So in the previous chapter, David remains in Jerusalem while the other men go out to battle. And as he's chilled in his own castle, he's parading and just maybe looking at the kingdom that God has given unto him, he finds himself on the rooftop. And there he sees Bathsheba. And then he sends a delegation to go and call Bathsheba, and then he sleeps with her. Bathsheba gets pregnant. And then in order to cover up, David calls for Uriah, who has been at battle, and he calls him to come, and he tries to persuade him and set him up so that he can sleep with his wife. But Uriah refuses, saying, I cannot sleep in the comfort of my bed while other men are out there engaged in battle. And now, giving up and out of desperation, David writes a letter, gives it to Uriah, so that it can be given to Joab. And then in the letter, he commands Joab to make sure that he puts Uriah in the front of the battle so that he gets to be killed. And then Uriah dies. And then the last verse of chapter 11 says, this thing that David did displeased the Lord. And so God sent Nathan to David. But Nathan, being a wise man of God, does not directly confront David, but instead he tells him, this very sad story about a man who had only one lamb, but the rich man actually refused to take out of his own flock, but he went to take this lamb. And now David becomes enraged, and rightfully so. I mean, who does not get enraged when we hear of all the injustices that happen about around us? Who does not get enraged when you hear about a young girl getting raped or a young boy getting molested? Who does not become enraged when we hear the escalating figures of femicide, particularly in the country where I am? So David became enraged. But just after he had declared that this man deserves to die, and secondly, he needs to restore tenfold, then the man of God looks at David and he says, you are the man. I just want to extract a few lessons, dearly beloved, that I would like us to learn from this morning. The first thing is that we have no idea of the depth to which we can sink when we take our eyes away from God. Away from the presence of God, anything is possible. And I mean literally, because here we see a man who has been brought up in a beautiful atmosphere, a young man who was so courageous, a young man who knew that you come in there with your sword, but I come in the name of the Lord, a man who had conquered armies in the name of the Lord. But just one glance away, just removing himself a bit from mission, a bit from the presence of God, we find him carrying or conducting himself in this way that is so wicked. I guess that is why Peter then says, the devil prowls around like a lion, roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. So we need to be vigilant and we ought to be alert at all times. Here you find David, he is lost, but he does not even know that he is lost. You know, to be lost is one thing, but to not even know that you are lost is even more frightening. So let us therefore be vigilant. And in accordance with 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5, we ought to always examine ourselves to see whether we are in the faith. We ought to constantly test ourselves. You know, sometimes when the word of God is spoken, we usually use it to test other people. We ought to test ourselves. You know, the pathfinders, once in a while, when they are drilling, there will be a command that says, 1, 2, check your step. 1, 2, check your step. So we need to also make sure that you do that, because sometimes it is easy to deceive ourselves and think when it comes to abuse, we are innocent, you know?
Even we as women, we are usually positioned as victims. We are usually positioned as the vulnerable, as the people upon whom these atrocities are conducted. And yet we as women have many a times used our power to influence that God has given us. We have used our power of influence wrongly. If we can even remember, we are in this mess today because of a woman, Eve, who did not just sin, who did not just want to exalt herself, who did not just want to actually be in this position, who did not want to be more than what God had created her to be, but also then incited Adam to also rebel. For the longest of times, women have used their influence to break up families. We have heard of wives who actually turn even husbands against their families. We have heard, I've heard of a man who no longer goes home to visit his family simply because he believes that umama wakhe uyamthakatha. And all of a sudden, the mother who used to be a nurturer, who used to be a caretaker, has now become this witch. And it will usually have been because of the wife who has been this influence. We have heard of mothers-in-law, of sisters-in-law. We have actually wreaked havoc in marriages to the point where they sometimes even break the marriage. We have heard of women who have actually shown preference on their families and neglect their in-laws, you know. And we have heard that one of the worst things to have is actually to have a boss who is a woman. Sometimes when women are in power, they can sometimes be so devoid of compassion. They can sometimes become so devoid of pity and empathy to the point where some people believe that it is much better sometimes to have a manager who is a man than who is a woman. Which is why I think we need to be careful, sisters. When God allows us to climb that ladder, when God allows us to be on top to manage, we need to be careful that it does not take away our womanhood. You know, we are known as people who feel, we are known as people who are empathetic, people who are compassionate, people who don't just look down, but people who go down. So how are you using your influence today, woman? At church, at home, at the workplace, and in your community? You know, I think Proverbs sums it up nicely in Proverbs 31, verse 28, when he says, the children rise up, her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, he praises her. He actually says, you know, many women have done well, but you, my beautiful wife, you outdo all of them. And what about you, brethren? You are given the God-given responsibility to lead your families, but are you led by Christ yourself? Do you have the mind of Christ that Paul speaks about in Philippians chapter 2, verse 3, when he says, let nothing be done through selfish ambition, but in lowliness of mind, esteem others better than yourself. In your leadership at home, are you esteeming others better than you? Are you the kind of a leader who is led by Christ himself, or are you lording it over your families? Have you adopted Christ's servant, a spirit of servant leadership, to the point where he not only got down to wash his disciples' feet, but he loved the church to the point where he died? Paul speaking about Christ says, let this mind be in you. That was in Christ Jesus, who did not take equality with God as something to be grasped. He did not take it as robbery. But what did he do? Instead, he humbled himself to the point of death, even dying on the cross. You know, some fathers abuse their God-given right to lead. They are monsters at home. They are lording it over every person, allowing everyone to slave away for them, and them not lifting up a hand. Which Christ are you following? Because the Christ you are following says, love your bride, even as the way as Christ has loved the church himself. And what about our children at home? Are we mindful not to exasperate them, but to gently lead them graciously, bringing them up in the training of the Lord? Have we made the marriage institution desirable or repulsive? Can our children attest that we are indeed followers of Christ? You know, one father said to his son, watch where you walk, dear son. But the son turned to him and said, watch where you are walking, dearest father, because I am following right behind you in your footsteps. Ellen White says in the book, Daughters of God, page 180, the measure of your Christianity is gauged by the character of your home life. And many a times, I say this sadly because I myself am implicated, many a times we have been kinder to strangers than we have been to our own families. We give the world our best side, we give the world the sunny side, but our families, our loved ones have to contend with a selfish and grumpy and ugly side of ourselves. It's almost like we've got this mask out there, we're smiling, oh, God is good, we're so nice and yummy, but when we come back home, we're so grumpy, we're sulky, we're discontent, we're complaining. Listen, dear beloved, unless you are a Christian at home, you cannot be one anyway. Unless you are a Christian at home, you cannot be one anywhere. In fact, here in South Africa, we have a musician, Uvusi Xemba. Some of you will know him. There is a song that he used to sing where he says, "Uhlekaza qethuke emizini yabanye abantu." Uhlekaza qethuke emizini yabantu. Meaning when you are outside in other people's household, you are so laughing, you are so excited, you are so happy. You laugh so loud that your wife opens, you even hang your head up, you know. And at home, kids want this side of you. They want this side of dad. I want this funny side of dad. I want this sunny side of dad. You know, sometimes at church, you are one thing else, and snyatila snyanyonga, we chat softly. But at home, we are roaring lions to the point where one tiny boy looking at his father, you know, acting up in church, pulled his mother's skirts and said, "Mommy, why can't we take this dad home? Why do we have to live with a monster 6 days a week, but then in church we get to see this side? Why can't we take this dad at home?" The dad you are, the mom that I am at church, the mom that I am in public, that is the mother I should be at home. My kids, my husband, ought to get the kinder, the funnier, the sunnier, the more happy side of myself. It is what happens behind closed doors, beloved, away from the crowd, away from the limelight. This is what happens in the private spaces that makes us a powerful witness to whether we are in Christ or not. And Jesus has warned us when he says, "Not everyone who says unto me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven." And he says, many will come to me that day saying, "Oh dear God, did you not preach? Did you not pray? Did you not convert many? Did you make many wonderful works? Did you not cast out devils?" And he says, "I'll look at them and I will say to them, 'Away from me, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity.'" So this morning, my prayer for myself and for you as well is that, search me, O God, and know my heart today. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is anything in me, anything that is maybe wicked in me, and lead me into life everlasting. It is my prayer that these words that were spoken to David by Nathan, that you are that man, will not one day be spoken to me one day, that you are that woman who is an abuser, or to you, that you are that man who is an abuser. May God bless you. And as we bow our heads for prayer, thank you, dear Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for another chance this morning. Thank you that your blood, even today, is still powerful. Here we are, having listened to your word. It is our earnest prayer that you may search us, that you may take up anything that is disgraceful in us, that you may take anything that is self-centered in us, that you may take anything that brings shame and disgrace unto your name. Here we are as mothers, as fathers, as creators of homes. We pray that you may create homes that are little paradises where angels love to dwell. This is our humble prayer in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.